Good morning, everybody, and welcome you all to the Best of Estoril Conferences initiative. The Estoril Conferences is an international platform to promote an open and intergenerational dialogue on the world's most pressing issues. And not just to promote a dialogue, but also to co-create innovative coalitions for action to solve those challenges. So in anticipation of the next edition that is going to be held in September 2022, so, you know, put it in your calendars, the Estoril Conferences are promoting a series of conversations and interviews with amazing past speakers like Jorge Quiroga here on the stage with us today. And really the purpose is to recover some of the most impactful interventions that happened in the past, really with the purpose of sharing the highlights and the highlights from the past and connecting them to the insights of the present. And the aim of these conversations is really to inspire what we're calling the purpose generation, right? Youth like myself, who are facing a world filled with challenges and complex issues, and really inspire this purpose generation for purposeful, meaningful action. So today, just to tell you a little bit about myself, I'm João. I'm a dancer. I'm a social and environmental entrepreneur, and I'm one of the youth ambassadors for the Estoril Conferences in 2022. I'm having a little bit of a fan moment by meeting Jorge here today, especially after listening to the sessions that Jorge did back in 2019. And pretty much today, I have the honor of bringing Jorge here on stage. Jorge was a previous speaker of the Estoril Conferences. You'll learn much more about Jorge today, but I would like to describe Jorge as a change maker from a very young age. It's hard to believe, but at age 37, Jorge was the youngest vice president in the history of Bolivia. But more than a young change maker, I also would like to describe him as a brave and lifelong steward of public service, democracy, and collaboration. So, Jorge, muchísimo gusto. I'm thrilled to have you here with us. And Jorge, to just kick us off, I was reading that you were born in Cochabamba, a city in central Bolivia in the Andes mountain range. I wanted to ask you really, you know, what was your experience growing up there? And how is it that experience informed who you are as a person today and what you wanted to do in the future?
Well, thank you very much, João. Muito obrigado. It's a pleasure to share this conversation with Estoril Conferences. And my congratulations on expanding and extending this to the Nova School. I think it will do wonders for the Estoril Conference. And I look forward to the 2022 event. Mark it in your calendar, as you said. I'm Jorge Quiroga. My nickname is Tuto, which is officially part of my name now, legally. My father gave me the nickname. I was born and raised in Cochabamba. All my grandparents came from there. A valley, a beautiful, quaint city in the middle of Bolivia. Brothers, sisters, a child. My father was an engineer, a civil engineer. And my first childhood recollections of him were spending 25 days on the field with a helmet on the Jeep, building a dam, hydroelectric project, and coming home 3-4 days a month and then explaining this to me. And I would go with him and I would see this dam being built, the water being contained. I always wanted to be an engineer, and he instilled in me a sense of public service. He had gone to school in Colorado, took him 6 years. He had to work his way through it. And he came back and built dams and provided electricity for a country that needed it. So from a very young age, I wanted to be an engineer. I was a mathematician, not a politician. And I wanted to be able to give back in public service like I saw my father do. So I think that's the inspiration that I got from childhood. Your parents are always very influential. And in my case, my father is an engineer, and my mother, who had a tough upbringing, she couldn't even finish school. She had to start working when she was 13 because she was an orphan. But even though she didn't finish school, she's got an incredible brain, photographic memory, was the South American bridge champion. I will never be a champion of South American anything. And she taught me how to play chess and do numbers. And so I think, you know, your parents help you become what you become. All the faults that you acquire along the way are my fault. All the good things are from them, and the public service and the giving back to my country came from Cochabamba, from my parents, from my upbringing.
Thank you, Jorge, for sharing. And it's kind of interesting, right? Because then I start now kind of connecting some of the dots, because then you go to the U.S., to Texas, also to study engineering. Is that right?
Uh-huh. Yes, I did. I always wanted to be an engineer. Well, I wanted to study engineer, as probably most of us. When I was 12, 13, people always say, in retrospect, later on in life that say, oh, I always knew he wanted to be president. That is not true. I wanted to be a soccer player. I wanted to dance in the parties at school, not as well as you, I'm sure, but I tried. But yeah, I wanted to study engineering, and I did, and I went to Texas A&M. I graduated from school early, and I went to U.S. universities, were still back then some of the premier institutions in the world. You know, if you wanted to get a good education, you try to go to the best places, and my parents sacrificed everything to pay for at least half of my schooling there, and I got there, and I studied engineering. I was good in math. I was the second half of my college career. I worked as a teaching assistant for calculus. I was a mathematician, as I said, and that helped me pave my way through it, and I went to school and did engineering. And it was sad to see that back then, in a very unstable Bolivia, my high school classmates that had stayed in Bolivia took 6, 7, 8 years to finish university with strikes and stoppages, and they didn't have the same opportunities that I was able to get through the sacrifice of my parents. So yes, I did go to engineering school. I then got an MBA later. Back then, things were very unstable. I stayed in the U.S. and worked as a professional systems engineer in IBM, the big computer company in the 80s. That was a widely respected company. I worked in the 80s in Texas, in New York, and I was a systems engineer, and I had a career path up the corporate ladder, shall we say. But I always felt that if I had those opportunities to study at a good school, to get good degrees, to learn professionally at a very large, important company back in the 1980s. This is before Microsoft, Google, and Twitters and all the rest. IBM was the king of the computer world back then. So those opportunities to me meant that I could either do one of two things: stay on at IBM and become one more of the thousands of people that work at IBM, where you can contribute, but they will not miss you if you're gone. IBM would have kept on going. Or realize that I came from a country that needed help, needed professional people to get involved, and needed public service. After all the training and the professional time that I spent at IBM, I looked for the opportunity, and I came to an inflection point where I had to start going up the corporate ladder at IBM, you know, one city per year for 20 years to see who gets to the top of the company, or go back to my country and try to give something back. My best childhood friend died in a plane accident, and that showed me that you may think your country is back there waiting for you and nothing will change. Things do change. And they're proud of me into going back and getting involved in public service in my country.
Thank you. Would you be able to kind of, the trigger event was almost kind of the, you know, when your childhood friend kind of died, and was that kind of what prompted you kind of, you know, coming back?
In a way, it shocked me into the following. You tend to think, you know, you're in IBM, you're in Armonk, New York, White Plains, New York, and Raleigh, North Carolina, computers, doing simulations, stuff that you never see back home. And you think you go back home for a vacation and you have a beer with your friends and eat some anticuchos and sandwich de chola and all our typical dishes, or silpanchos. And you think that that'll always be there. And it coincided with the fact that my best friend passed away in a tragic plane accident, and I had a decision to make. At IBM, you can stay at the local office and be a local branch employee for the rest of your life and have a comfortable living. Or if you're young, they put you on all the shooting star lists and all those things that they take you to New York and they try to entice you into taking the career. And I had to, at IBM, start making that move, you know, move to Dallas, out of the Austin, Texas office, move to Dallas or New York or Tokyo or wherever else. And then you start going up the corporate ladder, which is probably a fascinating career. And I know lots of friends of mine that have taken that challenge. So it was either start going up the corporate ladder and maybe more difficult to get off of that, or go home. And I think realizing that things do change at home, and my friend had passed away. In 85, Bolivia regained economic stability, democracy, and it seemed like there was a window of opportunity in the late 80s for professional people that wanted to give back to their country, that had an open opportunity to contribute to the development of the country, and that my father, engineer, helping public service, helping my country. I think that all converged into making the decision of going back, which I've never regretted, because I think, could I have helped IBM? Yes, probably 0.0001%. But you can do a lot more for your country if you get involved in public service.
Absolutely. I can relate a lot to that. I've lived almost 4 years in New York, and I'm always kind of impressed at kind of the, you know, this kind of how we move almost as if between bubbles, right? And kind of as we live in New York, and I'm now living in Brazil, and kind of really comparing those two different environments. I've also worked on a large corporate, and I also can relate to that feeling of also kind of being in a bubble in a way, Can you tell a little bit more about your experience of kind of breaking that bubble? Kind of like you took that decision, you landed in Bolivia. And how was it like, right? You know, landing in Bolivia, not for all it is, but kind of, okay, I'm living here now and I'm going to give back to my country. How was that kind of first impression?
Well, it was, it's certainly different because you get used to the professional work at a large company and the life in the States and going to New York and working with large computer systems. I mean, any of the large IBM customers that we had, that we sold them big mainframe systems, $10, $12 million back then money. Any of those customers that we had a more revenues than my country's, than the size of my country's economy. So it was different. You perhaps get into the habit of the U.S. corporate life, very structured, you know, be on time, don't be late, you know, do things today, don't leave until tomorrow. Some of the cultural differences that, you know, get in line when you go to the movie theater, don't skip the line, different things like that. But you also miss the fact that, you know, here at home, when we qualify for the World Cup, being in the stadium, watching your team play, Brazil, Argentina, those are things that that you start missing. And I came back through a UN-backed project to reform the administrative systems for government in Bolivia. It's more of a technical type of task. But back in the late 80s, Bolivia stopped hyperinflation. We regained democracy. And we got a lot of international help and professional people could come back and contribute. I was not looking to come back to be a president. I was looking to, like my father, with engineer, try to help a country that certainly Bolivia needed my help a lot more than IBM. And I think that makes the decision point. And yes, you do not leave in that little bubble. But I can tell you that later on, as I would go back in the States and catch up with my old friends, and they can't go out to dinner Friday because they need a babysitter and stuff, you also miss some of the support networks that we have in Latin America. Here, I grew up, and my four children were born in Bolivia, and we have aunts and uncles and grandmothers and family networks that are not quite there in a very large country like the U.S. or perhaps even in Europe. So yeah, there are differences. You certainly have more childhood friends and family, very strong family ties here in Bolivia from a personal standpoint. And from a professional standpoint, I started getting involved in doing that. And then, you know, a friend of mine who's a foreign minister, somebody that I knew, I did not come from a wealthy family or a politically connected family. I was just a professional that wanted to help. I started working. A foreign minister put his eye on me, saw me at a couple meetings, said, I want you to come advise me here. I started doing advising the foreign minister, negotiating with the other governments and stuff. Then a minister of planning who run development banks, very successful man, Enrique Garcia, he put his eye on a 29-year-old and said, I want you to come be vice minister of planning. Back then, foreign cooperation was very important for my country, the World Bank, the IMF, the Inter-American Development Bank. And I was, you know, I could negotiate in English. So I was in charge of channeling all the international cooperation, doing debt relief renegotiations with private banks, with bilateral aid and all that. And that required, you know, some competence, some ability to negotiate in English in Paris and Washington and Brussels. And I had that. And, you know, it was they kept opening those doors. And a president that some people thought was crazy, Jaime Paz Zamora, he had seen me in a couple of meetings and he made me minister of finance when I was 31 years old, Joao, and I looked like I was 20. Press just had a field. They say, what's the baby doing as a minister of finance? I mean, because I look 31 because of my mother's genes, I look like I just finished high school. So they had a field that, you know, he's not even of legal age and stuff. But I started doing public service that way, not setting out to run for political office. But when people back then opened doors for me, and I'm never one to think that you had your destiny and your mark, you know, somebody was saving you for that. No, it's people like Iturralde, Garcia, Pasamora, you know, ministers and presidents that opened the door for me to be able to contribute. And I try to respond to that trust that they bestowed on me to do the best work that I could. So one thing leads to the other, and you'd realize that, yes, you can do things as an advisor, but you can do more as a vice minister, and you can do more when you're a minister in terms of changing your country and helping your country. And in a way, I was in love with politics, you know, politics, polikos, make city, which is the noble definition of politics. As the degeneration of that, you know, politician sounds like an insult nowadays. But from the Greek etymological origin is polikos, is making city, and that's a noble life. And I realize lots of young people look at politics with a bit of disgust, but I will tell them that, yes, I understand it's good to do your own thing, make your own money. But I think if you come from a country like mine, you have to dedicate part of your life to help change your country. At least I had that strong feeling, and I started doing that, and doors were open to me. And you realize that the more responsibility you're given, the more you can accomplish, the more fraught it is, the more difficult it is, the more you get questioned. And then that led me to get involved into elective office in the late 90s.
Thank you, Jorge. There's like so many questions popping up. One thing I want to touch on is a topic you discussed in the conferences in 2019. It was kind of this idea that Latin America was kind of lacking what you called a spirit of Barcelona, like one of your soccer metaphors. And for me, it was interesting, right? Because a lot of your life seems to be the spirit of Barcelona in politics, both from your experience in government, but also later when you joined the Club of Madrid, and kind of always looking at kind of, you know, bridging collaboration. And I found that so interesting in a moment where actually right now there is more and more polarization. There is more fragmentation in the world, right? I wanted to ask you, can you unpack a little bit for us, you know, what do you mean for that kind of spirit of Barcelona in the making of the city?
Yeah, Joe, I think I was referring to the following. I admire the integration that Europe has had. You have many countries there that speak different languages. I mean, I barely get by in Portuñol, you know, a bit of Spanish and Portuguese. But you have countries with different languages, different religions, different cultures that have gone to war with each other, that have killed, maimed, and destroyed each other time and again. But in the second half of the 20th century, left all that violent past behind and worked on integrating through the greatest mechanism of countries coming together that has been created so far in the history of the world, the European integration. I realize people now may say, but look at Brexit. People are upset at the Brussels bureaucracy and many things that you can question that need to be perfected in terms of more fiscal integration. Yes, it's a never-ending challenge or a never-ending task to develop the full integration that the Europeans dreamed about. But you certainly made a lot of strides, and you do not have the levels of violence, and you have better integration, and you can buy products from each other, and you can move around, and it certainly changed a lot. I use that example a lot because in South America, we all speak the same language, pretty much, Portuñol, with Brazil. We all are pretty much Catholic. We all are culturally the same, you know, indigenous populations with European migration and mixing of races. We all come from mixed races. I'm indigenous. I'm from European descent. In the blender, we come out, you know, a little bit. You can all check all that with Ancestry or 23andMe. You can now see what percentage indigenous blood I have on my daughters and all that, and what percent Spanish or Portuguese or what have you. But incredibly, if you had looked at those two, Europe and Latin America, you would have thought Latin America is a lot easier to integrate than Europe. And lo and behold, Europe did advance, and in Latin America, we do not. And that's where I use the Barcelona metaphor. I said the only place where South Americans integrate together, work together, is in the front line of Barcelona, because back then they had Messi from Argentina, Neymar from Brazil, Suarez from Uruguay. I think at some point in time, they had Alexis Sanchez from Chile and Paraguayans. You know, they'll play well in Barcelona. You know, Messi didn't say to Neymar, I will not pass you the ball because I'm from Argentina, you're from Brazil. But if you look at the trade ministers in South America, that's exactly what they do. They put trade barriers. We don't work on integration. We manipulate exchange rates. So I was making the comparison that it's sad that the only effective South American integration was in Europe, in the front line of Barcelona, or now in Manchester City, or wherever these guys have, or PSG, wherever these guys keep moving to. But we do not practice that. And I think that is still true today. You can see that in the middle of a devastating pandemic, in this COVID-19 that is destroying our countries, there is no coordination in terms of access to vaccines, opening or closing borders. Is everybody on their own? You've seen a little bit of that in Europe as well. But at least, you know, with defects, there was a continental effort to get vaccines on an equitable basis. Down here is to each his own. And if Chile cuts its own deal with Pfizer, they get vaccines. And we don't have them in Paraguay, and we don't have them in Bolivia, we don't have them in Peru. And that is self-defeating, because as time goes by, there is no way that Chile can be okay if the rest of us remain unvaccinated and do not work together. So again, that spirit of Barcelona, of South Americans playing well in the front line, coordinating well in the front line of the soccer team, needs to be brought to bear in economic, health, and social issues in South America.
Thank you, Jorge. Going to the next thread on that conversation, yeah. Right? At some point then, you're not only the Ministry of Finance, but then you end up becoming president, and then kind of suddenly, kind of, you know, by coincidence and kind of all these kind of events kind of leading to them, you're at the lead of the country that you were born in. And how was your experience of, you know, you being someone who is kind of so keen and so connected to this spirit of Barcelona for collaboration, so committed to development with a sense of mission for your own country? How was the experience of kind of, you know, suddenly being at the front row, kind of being able to, you know, potentially be in one of the most powerful positions in Bolivia and taking an opportunity at really materializing that vision you had for the country?
It's certainly a great privilege, a unique privilege. I'm lucky personally in the following sense, in that the times that I've held high public office when I was minister, we had a great crisis because Argentina stopped buying gas. We had to raise taxes to make up for it, difficult times. But you learn. I think you, under fire, you learn more than in easy times. The same thing when I was vice president and then president. 98 to 2003 is called the lost half decade for Latin America. Devaluations, implosions, of economic implosions, debt problems, Argentina went under, Brazil devalued, the region was in turmoil. And I had to govern through those times, and you learn a lot more. And we kept things together. And I try to use that opportunity for some of the things that you mentioned. My country got the largest debt relief as a proportion of the size of the economy in the history of the world. It's called the HIPC initiative, highly indebted poor country. We wrote off all the public debt from the IMF, the World Bank, the IDB, bilateral creditors, $3.5 billion for a small country. And that money stayed inside the country and was dedicated for the next 20 years, still flows today, for health and education and social programs. So instead of the dollars going to Brussels or to Washington, they stayed in-house and we used them for poverty alleviation, which was one of the premier programs. I then helped other countries in Africa and Latin America try to follow our trail. We worked on changing the institutions. Corruption is a big problem. We follow the money, customs, tax collection, highway construction, all those agencies that were plagued by corruption. We put in good people with permanent boards, with a good civil service, which is something you have in Europe. You know, bureaucracy many times is used as an insult or in a pejorative fashion. Bureaucracy, you know, a permanent civil service or well-paid professional people that can navigate the state machinery is something good to have, and we try to build that. And in terms of integration, what changed the history of my country, again, 98-2003 were very difficult times, but in the midst of that, we built a project that transformed the economy of my country. We built a pipeline to Brazil. Speaking of integration, we have half of our border with Brazil, the very large country, but we lived with our backs to each other. We really had no connections, no trade, nothing to speak of. And we built an umbilical cord, the pipeline from Bolivia, Rio Grande, in Santa Cruz, with the gas coming from the south in Tarija, all the way to Sao Paulo, the largest market in this part of the world. As you know, Sao Paulo, if it was an economy, it would be the biggest one here. And we built that umbilical cord to integrate two countries with the greatest statesman that South America has ever had, Fernando Henrique Cardoso, who had this vision, first as a minister, then as a president, to make this come about. So we did work on that integration, and we, instead of having our backs to each other, we turned around, we hugged, we built a pipeline, and that dramatically changed the history of my country. Because when the 2004-2014, great decade of China buying commodities from South America at higher prices, at higher volumes came about, we were prepared because we had the pipelines with the gas to Brazil, the gas to Argentina. China drove up the price of oil. The price of gas went up. Brazil sold soybeans and Argentina sold soybeans to China and iron ore and copper from Chile and minerals from Peru and oil from Venezuela and coal from Colombia and tin, zinc, lead from Bolivia. Long live China. We had a very good bountiful time in the 2004-2014 Chinese bonanza. But I think the integration that we did in terms of gas, making my country the energy heart of South America, providing gas to the two giants, you know, Brazil and Argentina, certainly transformed the country. Now, I realize that that's how the cookie crumbles. Evo Morales with the Socialist Project came on in 2006, and we had left the gas reserves, we had left the pipelines, We had left them the contracts with those countries. We had left them higher tax rates. All he had to do is open up two gas valves, and he sold five times more gas at five times the price, because that's what was stipulated in the contracts. A lot of money came in. A lot of money was wasted and stolen and misspent. But it was definitely that integration that allowed us to change the history of my country. Now, that was then. Today, as you know, the world is going to less emissions. Oil is on its way out. Coal is on its way out. Gas can be a transition for a while. But God has been generous to my country. We have half of the world's lithium reserves. And here we are, zooming up a storm, burning up lithium batteries that I hope one day soon can be made in Bolivia, because we have half of the supply of lithium. And in the world where lithium batteries are on watches, on iPads, on cell phones, in cars and Teslas and motorcycles, one day in planes, I think there is a great future for my country in a green economy with the lithium batteries that we can manufacture here in Bolivia if we do things the right way.
Thank you, Jorge. And speaking to that, kind of, it seems that the country's trajectory, country's evolution across development is a very bumpy road. And these moments of huge promise are followed by moments of peril and of kind of, you know, questioning ourselves, what's happening? You know, why is development a linear trajectory, right? And and in a way, kind of, you know, for that next wave of promise, I'm sure there's going to be a lot of young people kind of listening to us that at some point, politics has been on their mind, as it was on my mind for a long time. When I both joined Nova and at high school, I was like, you know, maybe I was always driven for impact. And that was something that was like, you know, politics is a place for people who want to have impact. You know, but to your point, I was also like, I wasn't too sure about it. And so I was like, I'm doing work connected to impact, but I haven't worked in politics yet. And I think with me, there are a lot of young people out there that are still kind of considering, that have the drive, want to make a change, want to be engaged. They're like, no, is that really the place for me? It looks really tough. You know, what would you be your advice or your kind of your wisdom that you could share for young people that have that question in their mind like you did?
I would say, Joao, the following. Never have there been better conditions to join the public square and participate in public policy making than there are today for young people. Trust me, I did not have this when I was 20, when I was 25. I went to university in a day where I had a physical mailbox, where my girlfriends dumped me with letters. You know, you go to Texas and your girlfriend back home writes you three letters a week, then two letters a week, then one letter a week. And the next thing you know is goodbye. And you have to get out the letter and say, oops, it wasn't on Facebook. It wasn't on, I don't know how you break up today, quite frankly, when you're young. But it was, I remember the days when we were at university and somebody would come from Bolivia bringing a bottle of Singani, our local gin type, or Salteñas. And I was like, our little connection. Now everybody's interconnected, intertwined, interlinked. A young person in Bolivia can discuss and share things with a young person in Portugal, in Nigeria, in Algeria, in Texas, everywhere, that we did not have before. And when it comes to politics specifically, the old model was a political party, the center left, the center right, and the party boss, and the regional ones, and the local leaders, and you had to go to the office, and you had to deal with politicians that were old and didn't know anything, and you didn't like them. Trust me, I went through that. My parents would ask me, what are you doing in politics with these clowns? You know, there's a lot of clowns are in politics. And I would tell my parents is, if you don't join it, the clowns are going to run it. The vacuum will be filled by somebody else. But the difference today, what I was referring to, is that has changed so dramatically. Right now, to interact in the public discourse, you do not need to go to the bottom of the pyramid of a local party office to make it to the regional office to have somebody in the Congress get an initiative from you. You can interact directly with the congressmen, with the council people through social media. It has made it very horizontal. And you know this well, young people know this for a fact. I can give you examples of a political party X in a country, any country. And they put out a tweet, or they put out an Instagram, or they put a post on Facebook. They get 1% of the interactions than they get if it's a person, a human being, not the head of the party or the party logo or stuff. If it's the leader that is calling on the young people, gets 100 times more interactions. And clearly the days of the 5-page manifesto, 25-page manifesto are gone. Now it's, you know, quick videos on TikTok, short tweets and posts, but it's a very horizontal relation. And people in Congresses everywhere, in local councils everywhere, have to respond to young people that are very active in social media. It's not the type of thing where you vote for a politician and he says, thank you, and I'll see you in 4 years. No, it's every day. And that's the transformation that the social media has provided. If you want to pick a year, use Thomas Friedman 2007, the year that Google buys YouTube, that Facebook goes public, that Twitter goes public, that the iPhones come out, that Android comes out for the Samsung and the other operating systems. It is when all the computer power that I used to sell at IBM, located in refrigerated big offices with gigantic computers, and only us smart people could have access to that. Now everybody has it on their phone, and you have it on your phone. I mean, just so the young people can imagine this. If in the early 90s, if I had to travel with the ability to communicate that I have now with my cell phone, I go to Estoril tomorrow. 30 years ago, I would have had to take two trunkfuls of VCRs, TVs, fax machines, books, typewriters, computers, printers, all the stuff that I would have had to bring. Now I go with my phone, I type up something, I do the PDF, I send it, I do the video, I do the Facebook Live, just with a cell phone. 30 years ago, I would have needed two trunks. That change is only going to keep accelerating. And that will dramatically change the way you do politics. So if you are a young person 30 years ago, looking at all these people in the newspapers going, God, do I really want to mix with these clowns and these people? Probably not. Today, there's no excuse to not get involved, to not get active, to not participate. All you need is a phone and social media. And if you say things that people feel or are responding well to what you're saying, it will create movements. And you see that now in protest movements in Chile, in Colombia, and we saw it in the Arab Spring. I led the electoral observation mission for the EU on the first democratic election after Ben Ali left in Tunisia. And I was there, and you could see this democratic awakening and all these young kids that were doing things and mobilizing on Facebook. That change is here to stay. Yes, you will see authoritarian governments trying to shut down Facebook, trying to shut down social media. But if you live in a democracy with open systems where you can tweet what you think and post what you think without being criminalized or arrested, which can happen in a few countries, you have no excuse if you're young and are interested and are active not to get involved in changing things in your country, in your city council, in your region, in your Europe.
Thank you, Jorge. I think that's what a lot of us need to hear. I know that we're kind of right on time, so I'm just going to ask you one last question, Jorge, before we close off. At one of your panels, also in 2019, you shared this, you know, this really heartbreaking story of a Bolivian teenager who was murdered in Bolivia during protests. He was wearing a gas mask. He had one glove in one hand, a flower in another. And that image was so strong for me, kind of, you know, kind of listening to it. And I wanted to ask you, going back to today, who are the young people that inspire you? That kind of, can you pinpoint some examples of young people that are like, you know, this person is doing really good work, and kind of why? Who are the young people that give you hope about the future?
The name was Neomar Lander. He was a 70-year-old kid in Caracas, Venezuela. And he was protesting in Caracas. I went there a few times. And yes, Venezuela, Nicaragua are under the thumb of authoritarian regimes that kill young people. And in Venezuela, hundreds of young people were killed. In Nicaragua, hundreds of young people were killed in 2018. And that is something that young people should understand, that young people that in Portugal or in Spain or in Europe are tweeting and posting, you can do that. Use it. You can do that. Nobody will knock on your door and jail you. In other countries, they come in and tweeting is a crime and they arrest you, or they kill you in the streets when you're protesting and mobilizing. I would say two things that are very important now in terms of who inspires you now. I would say Nicaragua right now is going through a very difficult time. They have elections in November. And anybody who is saying, I want to run for office against Ortega and his wife Murillo, has been jailed. Four presidential candidates were jailed in the last week. Media people were jailed. People that used to be with the Sandinista movement in the 70s and 80s to kick out the Somoza dictatorship, now have to face the Ortega dictatorship. And Ortega is arresting former Sandinistas from the 70s and 80s who are against him and who do not want the same regime and who want to live in a democracy. There's a case that was very inspiring in Nicaragua. Comandante Macha, they called her, a young woman, 23, with breast cancer. And they were protesting, and hundreds were being gunned down in the streets of Managua in 2018. And she would go alternating between chemotherapy sessions, losing her hair, and going out in the street and swallowing tear gas and risking her life. They were trying to jail her. We talked to some friends in Costa Rica. She went across the border. She's living now in exile in Costa Rica. Had a child, and she's there. But she's always keeping up with things. And I'm sure that a person like that, who would go between cancer treatment to protesting in the streets to get democracy, is something that you have to take your hat off to. And she's still a very young person. She has a child, and I'm sure she deserves the right to go back and live in a free and democratic Nicaragua. And I'll close with a topic de rigueur right now. You get inspired by so many people in the health sector in our countries right now because of the pandemic and the COVID that are risking their lives. We're all at risk, but clearly the doctors, the nurses that are working in hospitals are being exposed more than we are. And in Latin America, under precarious conditions, they are sacrificing everything. And you see so many that have given their lives. And I was in Lima for the election last week, and I saw something very beautiful in the Colegio Médico, the organization that groups doctors in Peru. They had pictures on the gates. Instead of posters about vaccine stuff, they had a picture of every single doctor and nurse who have given their life trying to save others in the middle of the COVID pandemic. And I think that's the thing that we should, and it's hundreds of them that have done that in each and every country. And they should not remain nameless. They should have their picture, their name, and tribute paid to them for what they've done. And I hope the world in this space with the Estoril conferences, with the Nova School, can help prod the world into taking dramatic action. You know, the COVID is an international thing. It started in China, got propagated in Europe, it came down from the US. Right now in South America, we are getting destroyed. And we see that you're all kind of opening up in the summer. Here we have the new variants coming in and getting hit, and we do not have enough vaccines. And if the world needs something, it's solidarity. I can tell you with frustration, Joao, the UN, United Nations Security Council, is the place where intractable issues go to die and never get taken care of. Syria, Ukraine, the Venezuela democratic crisis. You go to the UN Security Council and you know the drill. And it's frustrating if you're a young freedom fighter in Venezuela or Nicaragua. Because of China and Russia on one side and the US and Europe on the other side, nothing gets approved. Well, here we have. We need vaccines. We need patents to be shared, technology to be shared, production to be ramped up. Who makes the vaccines? The UN Security Council. Russia with Sputnik. China with Sinopharm, Sinovac. US, UK, France with AstraZeneca, with Pfizer's, with Moderna's, and Johnson & Johnson. This is the only problem that requires global coordination and paying tribute to the health workers that are giving their lives in terms of having 12 billion vaccines manufactured in the next few months. And in the UN Security Council, it is the only issue in which every veto-wielding member has something to bring to the table, vaccines. And, you know, the needles going into arms, people don't care if it's Russian, it's Chinese, it's British, it's French, it's American. Save lives. And to me, it is very frustrating that we are not coordinating efforts in this. How are we going to deal with climate change in the world? And there's a lot of young people mobilizing behind that. If we cannot say 12 billion vaccines by March of next year in arms in every country in Africa and Latin America, and then have the Russia, China, Europe, and the US say, this is what we're going to manufacture. This is the patent that I'm going to share. This is the production agreement I'm going to make with Mexico, with Nigeria, with South Africa to make vaccines. I think I'm diverging a bit off of the inspiration that you asked, but in a way, I think the best way to pay tribute to people that have given their lives and all the ones we have lost is to make sure that we vaccinate everybody and we have the means to do it. We just need the world to do it. And I hope the young people that mobilize behind climate change can now mobilize behind something very simple, a needle with a vaccine, with the two shots in every arm, in every country, in Latin America, Africa, and Asia, for the sake of a world that is free of COVID.
Thank you, Jorge. And, wrapping up and summing it up, if you had kind of, you know, one message, one sentence, right, for those freedom fighters, for this youth, as you just shared, kind of mobilizing around this cause, what would be kind of your one sentence, one message?
I tell my friends in Nicaragua, Venezuela, and Cuba is to paraphrase the powerful prose of the incredible preacher, Martin Luther King. He used to say, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we're free at last. I will tell my friends in Nicaragua, particularly now, you know, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, Nicaragua will be free at last. stay at it. You'll be free at last.
Thank you, Jorge. Thank you. Thank you for your time, for your passion, for your commitment, and for really being the spark that will light a lot of these freedom fighters all across the world. So again, all the conversations for the people who are listening to us at home, all the conversations linked to the best of Estoril conferences will be available at the Estoril conferences social media. So we've talked plenty about social media. You're going to find it, the link to this talk in Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, LinkedIn, you name it, and also in the Estoril conference website. And again, don't forget, in September 2022, we're going to have another edition of the Estoril conferences. Hopefully by that time, everyone around the world will be mobilized by this cause that Jorge shared with us today around getting everyone vaccinated for this global challenge that we're facing as humanity today, so we can move on successfully to the next big challenge, climate change and biodiversity loss. Jorge, amazing to meet you, and thank you.
Thank you, João. Thank you, Estoril. Thank you, Nova, and we'll see you in Estoril. I have to get my second shot sometime very soon, so I'm on the age bracket that needs it, but for the younger people, we need the vaccines. Hopefully, we'll see you in Estoril, all vaccinated, and sharing live interactions, and I'm sure we'll appreciate more the live sessions than this digital pixelated sessions, but it's a pleasure to be here with you, and see you soon.